Well, praise the Lord, all four of you. Come on, somebody say praise the Lord back. Praise the Lord. Amen. There you go. Now I know you're with me. Amen. Appreciate y'all coming back. Maybe we'll have a few more drift in as the night carries on, but it doesn't matter because we're here. We're going to expect that the Lord's going to move. Amen. Amen. All right. A couple of us are. Praise God. All right. Just want to remind everybody that we're going to have a first responders class. Be scheduled on March the 12th at 3 p.m. in the conference room. If you're interested in being a part of that, when you see Candy Williams. Also starting the bridge class on the 12th of March. So if you're interested in joining the church, it's mandatory you go through the eight-week bridge class. And we'll have also a Wednesday night class in conjunction with that Sunday morning in case you can't get here on Sunday morning. I know we have a lot of van riders that like to take advantage of that. Brother Phil wants to remind us all that we still have the men's retreat on schedule for April 21st and 22nd. You get with him if you're interested in going to that. Still have a wedding. Amen. We're still got love in the air. Wrapping up February, but love is in the air still. And March the 11th at 5 p.m. Shauna Kellum and Billy Ray Ashcraft. And we need to remember Billy Ray and his family as his grandfather passed away earlier this morning. And we're starting our corporate fast on March the 7th and be going for 40 days. Sign-ups will be out in the foyer very soon. Amen. If you're interested in helping out with our van ministry, then please get with Sister Loretta Edwards, who's not here at the moment. But if you catch her and you feel like you can help out on a Sunday morning to feed the van ministry, that would be very, very awesome. All right, we're going to be praying for the Benton Pentecostal Church of God this afternoon. Pastor Dave Witt, also the Norfolk Island, and the missionaries to Ability Tree, Joe and Jennifer Butler. Amen. Would you stand with your feet with me this afternoon? Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Ask Him to bless these ministries and bless this service tonight. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you so much for another day, God. Thank you so much, Lord, for the opportunity to come back, Lord, and to be in service, Lord, to partake, Lord, in your word, to partake in worship and in praise. Lord, to just lift you up, God. We may be few in number tonight, God, but our hearts are full, Lord, to be able to be in this place, God, and just to honor you, to glorify you, Lord. We thank you so much for that, Lord. God, we lift up tonight the Benton Pentecostal Church of God and Reverend Dave Wilt, God, and just ask that you are blessing them, God, that you're pouring out your spirit upon them, God. Lord, that you're lifting them up, strengthening and encouraging them, Lord, in this last hour, God. Lord, that they are fulfilling your purpose, Lord, in this day and age, God, Lord. Asking you, Lord Jesus, to continue, Lord, to have your hand upon them, God, to give them the vision, the direction, the guidance, God, that only comes from you, Lord, to supernaturally impart to them, God, your wisdom, your knowledge, your understanding, Lord. God, help them to see what you see, Lord God. Lord, have a harvest of souls, God, to come in to their midst, Lord God. Equip them, Lord, in every way, and continue to bless them in Jesus' name, Lord. Lord, for the believers in Norfolk Island, God, asking, Lord, that you touch them. God, that you're encouraging them, Lord. We stand with them tonight, God. Lord, we're asking for your blessings and for your favor to be poured out upon them, God. Lord, we just seek you, Lord, on their behalf tonight, Lord. Lord, thanking you for favor, thanking you for direction, thanking you, God, for the mighty miracles and works, God, that you're doing in their behalf, Lord. Thanking you, God, for raising them up, Lord, and Lord, just letting them experience a tangible presence, God. Lord, as you are with them, Lord, even as you are with us today and tonight, God. Thank you so much, Lord. We lift up our missionaries, Joe and Jennifer Butler, God, asking, Lord, for your anointing upon their ministries, God, and that you are fulfilling in them, God, everything that you would have them to do, Lord, that's your purpose, God, for every person that they touch, Lord, with a disability, God, that you are encouraging them, Lord, in their minds, in their bodies, God, that you are providing for them spiritually, physically, emotionally, and financially, God. Thank you, Lord, for touching them. Lord, we lift up Israel to you again tonight, thanking you so much, Lord. Lord, for our alliance with them, God. Thanking you so much, Lord, for the opportunity and the privilege to be a blessing, Lord God. Lord, to speak a blessing over them, Lord. And we thank you, God, for keeping your hand of protection upon them, God, for continuing to watch over, continuing to uphold your word, God, even at this time in life, God. thanking you, Lord Jesus, God, for the mighty exploits that you continue to do through that nation. Lord, we're praying, God, that all eyes over there, Lord, would see you, Jesus, as being King of kings and Lord of lords, God. Thank you so much for what you're doing. God, we thank you for being in this house tonight, Lord. We thank you, Lord, for your presence here tonight, God. And Lord, we just seek you, God. Lord, we just desire, Lord, to be closer to you tonight, God. We thank you, Lord God, for the opportunity to lift you up. Lord, to acknowledge you as our creator, to acknowledge you, God, as our savior, God, our redeemer, Lord, our healer. Lord, you're everything, God, that we could possibly need or want, God. We give you praise, glory, and honor in Jesus' name. Come on, church, let's give him a hand clap of praise. Thank you for being in the house tonight. Amen. Turn to two or three people real close to you, shake their hand, hug their neck, let them know you're happy to see them in the house of the Lord tonight. All right, praise the Lord. You gonna be by yourself tonight, Brother Ray? Get somebody help Brother Ray take up the offering. Anybody? Trent, you gonna help him out, baby? All right, Jonathan's gonna help too. All right, praise the Lord. Amen. We want to give to the Lord tonight in our tithe and offering. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you so much for your blessings, Lord. We thank you, God, for the opportunity to give tonight, Lord. I pray, Lord, that you bless both the gift and the giver. Lord, that you press it down, shake it together, and cause it to run over for the advancement of your kingdom, God. We give you praise, glory, and honor in Jesus' name. Amen. Praise God. Y'all stand and help us worship tonight.
Welcome back. Was this morning not a great service?
Amen.
It was awesome. I'm stalling for just a second because I need to drink water. But I do want to welcome my nephew, Jake. He's up there. Y'all wave at him. You can't miss him. He's like 6'4". Five, excuse me. He's like a Goodman. He's really tall. Something that I said before we started practicing today, I want to repeat now. This morning was incredible. It was awesome. I hope I never forget it. I hope I never take that kind of a service for granted. But I can't live off of it. So as I stand here before you now with a smaller crowd, I ask God, what do you have for us tonight? This morning was awesome. What do we got tonight?
Something awesome.
Something awesome. I love this church. I just can't get over it. I love this place. I love to walk in this building, even when there's no church going on, because when I walk in here, I feel the presence of God, and it's something I'm not going to take for granted. Y'all join with us? and he's coming here for you. So make a way for Jehovah to come in. Y'all hang in there, Amen. I want to invite y'all, as we just sing this song, if you want to come to the front, if you have a burden, if you need Jehovah to make a way for you, this is kind of an intimate setting. I have this feeling, this solemn presence of God tonight. And Justin and I talked a little this afternoon, and it feels deep. It feels solemn, like heavy. Not real celebratory, but it's like a healing feeling that I feel, like it's going to flow slow and strong. If there's a need in your life, don't hesitate. Don't hesitate, like this is the pool of Bethesda. The waters are troubled. The power of God is in this building. You need help.
Forever, give him praise.
That's all forever. Give him praise. Y'all stay on that E minor again. The other thing that I feel like the Lord has spoken in my heart tonight is this next song is called Outer Courts. And I had this picture in my head this afternoon as I was preparing this about those who stay on the outer courts. They want the warmth of our fire, but they don't want to come all the way into the Holy of Holies. They don't want to come into the unadulterated presence of God, the pure presence of God. And I know a lot of you know the story of the veil that stood between the Holy of Holies and every human being. One human could go in there, the high priest, and they had to tie a rope around his ankle in case there was any sin in his life, because he could be struck dead. And that's an oppressive thing to live under. But when Jesus came and he died and he said, "It is finished," and the earth quaked, and people came out of the grave. It's in Matthew. When he died, people came out of the grave and walked into the city. And the veil that separated mankind from the Holy of Holies was ripped from the top down. That means you can be a filthy sinner and walk into the Holy of Holies with no fear of being struck dead. No fear, because Jesus took your punishment. He paid the price, ripped the veil, and you can walk in. But every week, we have people on the outskirts. They stay in the outer courts. They don't want to come all the way into the Holy of Holies for whatever reason. And if that relates to you in any way, come in to the Holy of Holies. Doesn't matter what's in your life, what's on your life, what you've done, you can come into the Holy of Holies where Jesus is waiting, where the unadulterated power of God, the pure presence of the Holy Spirit waits for you. Take me past the outer courts into the holy place, past the brazen altar. Lord, I want to see your face. Pass me by the crowds of people, the priest will sing your praise. Lord, I hunger and thirst for your righteousness, but it's only found one place. Take me past the outer courts into the holy place, past the brazen altar. Lord, I want to see your face. Bless me by the crowds of people, the priest will sing your praise. Lord, I hunger and thirst for your righteousness, but it's only found one place. So take me into the hole.
Take me into the hole.
and take me out by the blood of the Lamb. Take me into the holy of holies. Take the coal, cleanse my lips, here I am. Take the coal, cleanse my lips, here I am. Take the coal, cleanse my lips. Thank you. Prepare the way. Prepare the way. Prepare the way for the Lord. Prepare the way. Prepare the way. Prepare the way for the Lord.
You could consider for just a moment that everything that's gone on this week has prepared you for this day. Everything that you've encountered, everything you've been going through is preparing you for this day, maybe even this moment. We know there are no accidents in Jesus Christ. We know that the Lord prepares everything before us. The Bible says it's line upon line, precept upon precept. It just builds up for that perfect moment where God can step in and do the work. So, Lord, I say thank you that there are no accidents in my life. I say thank you because we are here today because you have brought us here. I thank you because all week long you have been preparing us for this moment. And I thank you for that. God, right now we lay everything else aside at your feet because there's nothing worth missing this moment for. There's nothing worth missing this presence for. There's nothing, Lord Jesus. Nothing, Lord Jesus. That, Father God, at this moment we lay everything at your feet, so all of our problems are yours. All of our issues are yours. So that, God, you could come in through the softening of the worship, Lord God, as we've been telling you how much we exalt you. Lord, you've been preparing a path to our heart for the word that you have tonight through Pastor Justin. There is something you're trying to do here tonight. And, God, I don't want to miss it. Because it may be that what happens tonight carries us on through the rest of our week. It may be that you're preparing us tonight for something else that's going to take place this week. That's not unlike you. So we lay down our problems. We lay down our infirmities. We lay down our broken hearts. We lay down our sickness. We lay down our mourning, Lord Jesus. We lay down everything that competes for your glory. It competes for our attention with your presence. We lay it all down right now. Because, Lord, all we want is you. We hunger for you. God, may we drink even deeper. May you increase, Lord Jesus, the reservoir of that spirit inside of us, that we are sad less, we are frantic less, but we are more in love with you. Let our love and our appetite for you, Lord God, ever be increasing, while the appetite for this world is ever decreasing inside of us. Even as John the Baptist said, you must increase, I must decrease. God, I thank you. I thank you, Lord. Just feel the need to do this right now. Would you just reach over somebody next to you? Put your hand on their shoulder right now if you can. Can we just take a moment? Let's be the body. The Ephesians 4 body, where we pray for one another right now. Lord Jesus, I say thank you. Thank you for these that are next to us, Lord God. We find worth and we find value in their life. And we speak into their life right now joy. We speak into their life peace. We declare your presence, Lord God, to be greater in them. We lift their needs up to you and ask right now that, Father, you would meet their need, that you would touch them, that you would bless them. That, Father God, right now, would you move move in their life. Let there be your peace. Let there be your strength. Let there be your heart, Lord Jesus. And whatever their greatest need, Lord, is, meet that need so that they can see Christ greater, Lord Jesus, than what they saw you when they first got here. Do something magnificent, Lord, in their life. Do something magnificent, Lord, in their life. God, we just give you glory. Glory and honor and praise in Jesus' name. Somebody love the Lord, said amen. Amen. You may be seated if you can. My. It is an amazing thing, Mr. Phil, how we just show up and God's already here. God moves in this place. God moves in this place. I love it. I enjoy hearing Pastor Justin speak. When I was his age several decades ago, I just wished I could have brought the word the way he does. He has a much better clarity and grasp on it than I did. I value, because I believe God has laid a word on his heart for us for this very night. I'm ready to hear it. Have you ready to hear it? Come on up here, Pastor Justin. I value him and Courtney. Behind every great man is an even better woman and a very surprised mother-in-law. Yes. I value this man. Stretch your hands out towards him, Father. Your anointing be upon him. Your thoughts be his thoughts. Your words his words. And Father God, there's a word I need to hear tonight. Lord God, let Pastor Justin bring a word that I need to hear, that we need to hear. And that, Father, I pray, impact eternity, Lord Jesus, through the words that you bring. We give you praise in Jesus' name. Amen.
I'm going to move this. Y'all pray for me as I speak, just because my heart is heavy with this. So, help me to fight past these good emotions. It's really just what God's doing is I'm honored to be a part of. And so I don't want those emotions to get in the way of what he wants to say. I do want to ask you to do something for me that's a little out of the ordinary, and hopefully it's okay. If you just absolutely don't want to, guess what? You don't have to. But can everyone sit around here? Just I want us to sit together. If you're offended, come next Sunday morning and you'll hear about how you shouldn't be. So sorry about it. Pastor Mike hit the nail on the head right there, that last thing we did, praying for each other. And about us being a unit and a body, and that's something I want to touch on a little bit tonight, is how we're supposed to be a body. You know what? Well, I'll stay up here for a second so I can do that. You just feel so far away. So I've been struggling with this word, and you can ask Courtney. I just talk to her and tell her I just don't know about this. This is something that's uncomfortable for me. It's not something I feel completely just like I know it all. And I know I don't feel like that about any part of God's word, but there are certain parts that I feel like I know a little more about than other parts. And I'm sure you feel the same way, but this particular part I struggle with because it's something that we never really get deep into. We kind of scratch the surface of it. And I'm going to read a couple scriptures. The first one being in John chapter 20, I believe it is. Yes, John chapter 20. We'll read verse 22. Now, this is before the day of Pentecost, and I want to point that out for a reason. I'm going to come down here at first. So just keep that in mind as we read this. This is before the day of Pentecost. So let me pray real quick, and then we'll get started. God, thank you so much for tonight. God, thank you for your presence here. Help us to not leave that, God. Help us to stay right here in your presence, God, and allow your word to go forth and do exactly what it needs to do in our hearts, God. Let nothing be guarded about us, no walls put up, God, but let all those things fall in the name of Jesus right now so that the word of God can penetrate our hearts and change us, God, to make us more like you, Jesus. We just want to be more like you, God. Help us in that tonight. Help me to speak this word clearly, God, boldly, God, with authority and accurately, God. That's all you've asked me to do, God. The rest is up to us to respond to it. And I thank you for that, Jesus. Amen. So, John chapter 20, starting in verse 22, it says, "And when he had said this, he breathed on them and said to them, Receive the Holy Spirit." Now, I want to talk tonight about the Holy Spirit. Again, this is something that is difficult for me just because I feel like it's so vast and there's so much to be learned about it, and I not dare speak wrongly about it. And so I don't want to speak wrongly, and I want, that's why it's just so hard for me to talk about it, because I don't want to be wrong about what I'm saying, and I don't think I am. I know God has a word for us tonight, and I'm going to trust that. But, and it's not going to be a long word. I don't have a lot to say because I want us to do something. I want us to put this word into practice tonight. And so we're going to do something once we're done here. I can't get that to work. That's okay. The devil's a liar. Anyways, so we've heard talked about a lot when we refer to the Holy Spirit. Most people are going to go to Acts chapter 2 on the day of Pentecost when 120 of the believers, they were together in the upper room on the day of Pentecost, and it said a sound like a rushing mighty wind came through, filled that place where they were at. And they all received the baptism of the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other tongues. And there were devout men of God standing outside from all tribes and nations. And as they began to speak in other tongues, they were speaking the languages of the men standing outside. And these men were amazed, like, how do these uneducated men know my language? How are they speaking in my language? The mysteries of God. And so they were kind of immediately just drawn to what was happening. And then you hear the joke about they're drunk, and then Peter says, "No, it's only 9 a.m. We hear those things. This is the scripture that most people go to, which is fine. That's great. But there's something much more than what happened on the day of Pentecost. It's something that continually happens throughout the book of Acts. You hear my dad saying it a lot, and Pastor Mike says it, but be being filled is what he likes to say a lot, and I want to kind of get into that, because as a church, I believe wholeheartedly, and hopefully you do too if you've been here any measure of time, that God has marked us and that God has called us to do a certain thing in this region and to impact this area. And so this is so important for us to get tonight. We will not be able to do what God has called us to do without really taking to heart this message tonight and applying it to our lives. We will not be able to do what God is bringing our way. It won't be accomplished unless we get this tonight. And so I don't want to miss this. I don't want you guys to miss this. So we read that they're filled with the Holy Spirit, and Peter goes outside and he preaches to them the gospel, basically. And they say, the word says that they're cut to the heart with the message. And they say, what must we do to be saved? And Peter tells them the famous Acts 2:38, "Repent, be baptized, every one of you, in the remission of your sin. In the name of Jesus Christ, be baptized, Holy Spirit," that whole thing. And so he tells them that, and that's what happens. But then two chapters later, in chapter 4, actually, let me get chapter 3 first, where you see the lame beggar at the gate. Beautiful. And something I find interesting, and this is just a little rabbit trail real quick, is that it says people would bring him to the gate. And so I think this is a setup to show us how much we need the Holy Spirit. Because the people of God who were going to the temple to pray, the hour of prayer, would take him and they would set him at the gate. The question is, why didn't they bring him inside? Why didn't they set him outside? And I think it's because, one, they lack the power of the Holy Spirit. Pastor Mike used the word this morning that you're going to hear me say tonight. I think they were ignorant in what Jesus had sent to them, being the Holy Spirit, and given them the ability to do. Okay? I want to point out real quick that while the disciples were with Jesus, they operated with Jesus. Okay? They would spend time with Jesus. Jesus would share with them the word and speak to them the word and who he is and kind of change their way of thinking from that works of the law into being saved by grace and those things. But everything they did was rooted out of Jesus. They would go back to Jesus and he would send them out. They would go back to Jesus, he would send them out. He would fill them up and send them out. And so there's this pattern that happens. And so when Jesus has been resurrected and he comes and visits them in that John chapter 20, verse 22, and says he breathes on them and tells them to receive the Holy Spirit. And so, and there's such a great emphasis on the Holy Spirit in John chapter 15, 16, 17, he talks about these things, that I must go away so that one will come. And this one will lead you into all truth. He will be your helper, your comforter, and he's going to teach you some things and give you the power and the ability. He's basically going to do what I was doing while I was here with you. He's going to do exactly that. But I have to go. So I have to send someone back to help you. Now, this may be debatable. Now, I know there's probably Trinitarian believers and oneness believers in here. But they're the same God, okay? There's no difference. But Jesus and the Holy Spirit, they are the same. And so Jesus says, I have to go so that he can come. But there's such a great emphasis. He you can search it. He says it so many times before he goes. And then he even comes back to visit them for just a split second to remind them again. Receive the Holy Spirit. And tells them to go to a place and wait. So why is there such emphasis on receiving the Holy Spirit? Is the question. Is why? And I think we see a glimpse of that, like I said, in Acts chapter 3 where the lame beggar is there. And I'm sure many church people had passed him by. And didn't really know what to do with him, okay? Because they were still in this old way of thinking. In this new way of thinking, Jesus says, I'm giving you something that's going to allow you to do things, not magic tricks or whatever, but I'm going to place inside of you the Holy Spirit, being me, and you're going to be able to do, like he said, greater things than I did. And so we get a glimpse of that. Well, they heal the lame man, and then they get some stuff about it when they go inside. The Pharisees and Sadducees, and they're talking about how they healed him, and now there's a crowd following him and causing problems, similar to what happened to Jesus, is they were always against him because of the people that were following him and the threat that it might cause on their government and their way of life, and so they were threatened when these people started following Peter and them because of what happened with the lame man. He says he was lame for 40 years, and this kind of thing had never happened before. And so what happens is they tell him to stop speaking in the name of Jesus, stop teaching about these things. And the first thing that they do after they hear all these things is they go back to the body of believers and they begin to pray. They begin to pray. And what do they pray for? They pray for boldness to continue speaking. And in praying that, the Bible says, the place where they were began to shake and they were all filled. So again, we see it happen a second time. It's Acts chapter 4. And I'm telling you, it's mentioned, I know in the ESV, 42 times in the book of Acts. And they were filled, and they were filled, and they were filled, and they were filled. So there's this great emphasis on there's something that we don't have that we need in order to do what God has called us to do. And I know that again, like we say on Sunday nights, this is the church. These are the people that really love God because they're here on a Sunday night. But and so it's another reason why this message is hard to preach, because I know you've heard these things before. They're not strange to you. But something that I believe we're missing that we don't practice is this continual infilling of the Holy Spirit. But not just as individuals. Something else I notice when I read the scripture is never, and correct me if I'm wrong, shout at me, I don't care. But I don't read in this book of Acts when the church is starting and the Holy Spirit is poured out, where you read about one person being filled. They're usually together. They're together. The closest to one person is when Ananias is commanded to go to Saul, who becomes Paul, and lay hands on him so he can receive the Holy Spirit. But in that, there's two of them. Okay, and so I've been wondering, you know, why is there never just one person? I'm not saying that if you're at home in your prayer closet and you can't receive the power of the Holy Spirit. I'm not saying that. It's not what I'm saying. But I'm saying there's something that takes place that's just sets us up to do something for God that we can't do by ourselves. When we come to a place as a body of believers and we sit together and we're one mind and one accord and we believe on these things, and then the Holy Spirit fell. And so they're always together. And so again, I know you know these things, but something, and that's why I have this here, that God is showing me is this is the state of the church. I believe there's three types of people, and I'll get these set up here in a second. Here's my poker. There we go. There's certain types of people in the church, okay? It's one, we're not all on the same page, and that's why you have different types of people. And we need to get on the same page. But I believe that there are people who have a saving knowledge of Jesus Christ. They do. They're saved. But what they don't have is the Holy Spirit. They're not filled. They've not been filled. And obviously, you cannot tell me, you can read the New Testament and say that, it's not important to be filled. You're not going to convince me of that. That's not the truth. That's a lie you're listening to. But there are people who are not filled, never been filled. And then there are people who have been filled. And then I'm going to show you something that happens. As there's people that have been filled.
Back in our reprobate mind and the position that we're in before we have. have those people in the church. It's not that they're not saved. It's not that they don't have a relationship with Jesus. It's that they're not doing it. There's a parable Jesus gives that talks exactly about this. And it's the parable of the ten. It's what does he do? He gives them two of the talents. He gives one of them five, gives one of them two, he gives one of them one. And he says, I'm going to go away and I'm going to come back. And he goes away and the one with five turns to ten, the one with two turns to four, and the one with one, well, he just keeps it. And Jesus comes back and he tells the first one, good job, well done, good faithful servant. Same thing to the second one. He gets to the first one who decided to just hold on to him. And he calls him a slothful and wicked servant. Because he didn't do anything with it. And so this is the state of the church all across America, all across the world. It's not that they're churches who don't know Jesus and don't have a relationship with Jesus, but they lack the ability to apply the Word of God to their life.
Yeah. Yes.
Because we need the Holy Spirit to do that. If we can't utter the words, Jesus is Lord, without him, what makes you think that we can do anything for him?
Right.
Without that power, without the Holy Spirit. And so you have people who've never been filled. You have people who were filled 5 years ago, but it's been a while, and they wonder why they lack passion or motivation or dedication, that their prayer life has gone down, their reading life has gone down, and they're wondering, they're sitting there wondering, like, why can't I get motivated? And anybody who's been in ministry for any period of time, that's kind of where I'm at, if I could be vulnerable. This is why I believe God gave me this message, this for me, is I haven't been in a state of continually being filled poured out. We are filled for one purpose, and that is to be poured out. That's the only purpose that we have, is to be poured out. So this is how it should look. We have a saving knowledge of Jesus. We know who he is. We just don't have the ability to apply that word to our life and be effective Christians, powerful Christians. Give words of wisdom and words of knowledge and speak life to the people.
Yeah.
People who are always listening to the voice of the Holy Spirit when walking through the Walmart, they're on their job or whatever, they're so sensitive to this voice because they're continually being healed. And they're not allowing the things of the world to poke at them and drain them of what God's doing in their life. And so what is supposed to happen is we get filled up and we pour out. If we do that, if we just do that, this is the other problem. You have people who are being filled, but they wait until they're all the way poured out to get filled up. There's an issue there. There's something that happens there when we exhaust ourselves in these states. Instead of continually being filled and poured out, we wait until we have nothing left, and we wander into these seasons that God never intended us to be in. I'm not saying wilderness seasons that God doesn't lead us to those seasons. I know the Spirit of God led Jesus into the wilderness. I know there are places that God leads us, but there are wildernesses in our life that God never intended us to be in. Because we're not in a continuous state where we feel we have exhausted ourselves. And now we're in this valley for not a God-given reason, but because we have yet to get back into his presence and allow him to fill us back up to use him. And so it's an unnecessary place that we're in. It's we're not supposed to be there. God's saying there's work to be done. You're like, I don't have anything else to give. And God's saying, well, come on back. And so that's how, this is how we as a body, not just individuals, should be. We should pour some out. We give words of wisdom. We are used of God for tongues and interpretation. We lay hands on people and they're healed. But we never run out. We're continually being healed. We always have something to give. And this is, like I said, the majority of the church is what needs to happen is you need to have people who basically they're like this, but it's just running over. You know what I'm saying?
And so I know, again, that we've heard these things. We've heard these things preached. We know about these things, but this is something that we have done as the church, is we've made the Holy Spirit an emotion. We've made him this thing that you can only attain if you come to church. And this feeling that you get of excitement and the goosebumps and the and when the noises and the and Phil's playing the right songs, man. He's playing the right songs and Pastor Ed gets up there and he just really revs me up and gets me ready for service and just all these things. That's not it. That's not it. If that's what you need, then most likely this is what you are. If that's what you need when you come to church. But if we come to church and we're like this, then we're ready to be used of God. We're ready. We don't need anybody to come up here and cheer us on and make us get excited about the things of God. And that's, again, because we've associated the Holy Spirit to, we've made him to be this feeling that is only attained when things that we enjoy happen. And that is not accurate at all. Not accurate at all. That's not who he is. That's making him to be something that he is not. And so as a church, we are required to be in a state of being filled. Jesus would not have emphasized this so much, and you wouldn't have seen the apostles throughout the book of Acts is what happens. They get filled, and then they speak the gospel to people. People are saved, people are healed, people are added to the church, and then they get filled again, and people come against them, and problems come against them, and what do? They pray, and they get filled again, and then they're going and doing the work of God, and you have Stephen who's operating in the Spirit of God, and he's speaking at the courts or whatever, and while he's speaking, he's full of the Holy Spirit, and he's getting stoned to death as he's still speaking, and he kind of mimics what Jesus says and basically says, "Forgive them, for they know not what they do. God, don't hold it against them." Jesus, and these things are not possible if we're not in a state of field. We're field. These things are not made possible, because what happens is when we're empty, this means you're full of yourself. This means you're full of yourself. And if you're full of yourself, you have nothing to give. Nothing to give. When God asks you to do something, if this was Stephen's state of mind, when he was asked to go speak, well, he wouldn't have been there. He wouldn't have gone and done that. And that wouldn't have happened. But because he was filled with the Spirit, there was no fear in him. There may have been fear knocking at his door, but the power of the Holy Spirit inside of him gave him that ability to say no to the fear and to continue to speak with authority, with boldness, not caring about the fact that he's getting rocks thrown at his head and about to die. Because that's something the Spirit of God, only the Spirit of God, is able to do. We are not able to do that. We don't have it in ourselves. Romans chapter 3, no one seeks God. No one understands him. No one is good. No, not one. That's us without him. We don't have the ability to carry out good. We can't do it. It's impossible. We only do it by the power of the Holy Spirit. And so if our church, my challenge to you tonight, and then something that I want us to do, is that basically, if we're going to go where God is taking us, if we're going to do what God is calling us to do, the only way it's going to happen is if we as a body decide that we can't do it on our own and we need the power of the Holy Spirit and we don't want to our church to enter into these valleys that weren't intended for us, and so we need to stay in a state of being filled and led by the Spirit of God. And if we're going to do that, like I said, we have to decide when we come to church, when we come to church, we should expect to be filled. To wait on a moment, again, where Phil's playing the right songs and Pastor invited somebody to speak to us about the Holy Spirit. If we're waiting on those things, then like I said, you're full of yourself and you lack. You're not being used by God like you could be. So we need the Holy Spirit. Jesus did not say that just to say it. And so if we're going to go where God is calling us to go, this has to be who we are as Christians, is a state of, and I'm convicted as I speak this, because like I said, I am in a place where God never intended to me to be spiritually, because I have let myself fall away from that continuously being filled, whether it be because of the busyness of my life or things happening, and I've overlooked the things of God. And so I've come to this place to where I'm like, man, like I have to make myself go do something, go speak into somebody's life. When I'm in Walmart, I gotta wipe that, because me, and if I am not careful, I am not approachable, I'll tell you that. My face is, I'm just doing what I'm doing, don't talk to me. And I know it's silly, but if we want to be used by God to impact this area, then we need to be in a state of mind, like I said, to where we're so sensitive to God speaking, the Holy Spirit speaking, that whenever he speaks, there's nothing of ourselves in our ears, and they are wide open to hear what he says. There's nothing plugging our ears for us to not hear what he says. And so, again, if we all agree that God has called this church to do a work in here, can we agree on that? Okay, can we all agree that we understand we cannot do that in ourselves? That we can agree on that. Okay, so what I want us to do tonight, we have plenty of time to do it. It's only 6:00, all right? Is if there is a way, and I want everybody to be involved. Everybody, well, let me rephrase that. Everybody who wants to be involved, I want you to be involved. Okay, don't just come join the party because you might look weird sitting in your seat alone back there. Come because you want to. You're ready. Is if we can play some music, and the reason I don't want Phil and them to do it, because they need some too, okay? So I just want us to play some music, and we're going to do something that's a little different. First, I want us to all come forward, and I want us to just pray together. Find a place next to somebody, and I want you to just begin to ask God to fill the person next to you. God, fill them with the Holy Spirit. There's power in that. All throughout the book of Acts, the laying on of hands, it is biblical. But I want us, if we could just line up to lay a hand on your neighbor and begin to ask God to fill them. And I know it's out of your comfort zone. I know it's something you're not used to. But I know that God says there's power in unity when we are all one body, one mind, one accord. And so I'm not asking you to pray for yourself. I'm not asking you to clean yourself up before you come. I'm just saying, come as you are. If you know Jesus as your Lord and Savior, I want you to come as you are and lay hands on the person next to you and just begin to ask God to fill them with the Holy Spirit. God, we thank you so much, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Holy Spirit, come.
these are praying here at the altar, church. I want you to join me with something. I think Pastor Justin has given us a right on time word. That word that we're desperately needing. I heard Pastor Justin say this. We are filled to be poured out. Filled to be poured out. And I would question just how well we do. As a church, where God's doing some great things and we are receiving great things, but how well are we going forward? How is God being able to use us from what we will absorb, what we receive of the Holy Spirit every week? How are we being used by God wherever we go to give God to the people around us? 16,000 people live within 10 miles of this church, and are we giving them Jesus to the degree that they need? We had one gentleman this morning, one gentleman who has had his life absorbed in drugs, who is a throwaway product of this society, lives within that 10-mile radius of this church, that God has saved that man, put him on a path of being off of drugs. That man this week, now get this, that man this week who has probably that cap right there probably contains all of his biblical knowledge. Would you say that's right? He's saved, but all he has enough biblical knowledge is that much, because he hasn't been saved all that long. He hasn't been off of drugs all that long. And yet that man with that much knowledge of God, who is coming to a church and is finding Jesus and is so hungry for what he has never had before in his life, he's getting something drugs couldn't satisfy. Okay? He said, I called 12 people, invited them to church. I called 12 people. I don't know what else I could do, but I know what they need, and I'm trying to get them here. And he told me and told Brother Phil this morning, said, I invited 12. I only got one. I got one out of 12. I even know that one never would have came had they not heard. Are we doing our utmost to take what we're being filled with and use it for His glory?
Have mercy on me, Lord. Hear my cry.
I want you to pray with me right now. I want you to pray with me right now that God would use our church. Now, Father, I pray, let us not be guilty of just receiving. My God, I pray, put something inside of us that says, I've got to get rid of what I have so that I can get more of you. That, Lord God, we are sponges that literally need to be wrung out so we get a fresh refilling of you. That, my God, I pray, let us be so full of you that your outpouring on us is so continual on Monday, on Tuesday, on Wednesday. That, Lord Jesus, we can't hold what we got, so it overflows, Lord. It overflows off of us onto those around us. That, God, we don't even have to go out in the public areas and blow a trumpet. You do it for us, Lord. Your countenance through us does it. That people will be attracted to the Christ that is inside of us. That, Lord, we don't have to do any holy gyrations. We don't have to be a people that are preaching on soapboxes. Your Spirit will naturally lead people to us. But, Lord God, let us be ready, Lord. Let us be ready to give an answer for the hope that lies within us. That, Lord Jesus, we are ready to give a prayer. We are ready to share a word. We are ready to give an invitation. That, Lord, there's something every one of us can do. And, God, I don't want to be guilty of being a church that is so full of you, and yet you are so dry when we leave this place. My God, I pray right now, fill us full of you. Fill us full of a determination. Fill us full of a hunger, Lord God, for you. For you, for you, for you, Lord Jesus.
Open my eyes to see your glory all the days of my life.
Did she just get baptized in the Holy Spirit? Oh my gosh. Hallelujah. Come on. Hallelujah.
This is my one chance.
Hey, look at me a
this
second.
This is my moment. Lord, I throw everything aside just to run blindly after you. This is my one chance. This is my moment. I want to see you. I want to touch you. I want to hold you. I
feel her so full
you.
With Jesus. I feel her so full with you. Father God, I pray right now, fill us all so full of you. Fill us all so full of you that, Lord God, we do not have enough.
All my hope is in you.
Jesus.
All I need is in you.
Fill us so full, Lord God. Fill us so full. It's one of our fundamental truths of the baptism of the Holy Spirit with the evidence of speaking in tongues. That's not a thing it's learned. Man, I grew up Methodist. You didn't do that. But I'm telling you, this is the Holy Spirit. And it's where you get baptized. The Holy Spirit comes on you. You speak in another tongue. That's not the gift. You get to speak in a tongue. But the fact is, it's that power that comes in, that prayer language you're able to use in God. If you've never been baptized in the Holy Spirit and you want to be, come stand right here up at the front. If you want to be baptized in the Holy Spirit, come on right now. Is there anybody here, you have never been baptized in the Holy Spirit and you want to be? We want to pray with you. Is there anybody else? Hallelujah. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus.
The more I seek you, the
all right.
More I
hey, I need some prayer
you.
Warriors. Come on, Pastor Stephanie. Come on. I need some people that know how to pray
the
people into the Holy Spirit. Come on. Come on, Sister Holmes. Gather around this woman right here. Gather around this woman right here. She wants to be baptized in the Holy Spirit. Get over there, Shirley.
I want to sit at your
Jesus,
feet, drink
Jesus,
from the
Jesus.
Cup in your hand, lay back against you and breathe. Feel your heartbeat. This love is so deep, it's more than I can stand. I melt in your peace, it's overwhelming.
Overwhelming.
Jesus.
Hallelujah.
I want to be more like you. I want to be a vessel you work through. I want to be more like you. Sing it with me, sir.
Is there anybody here tonight? You've been really dry in the spirit. You've been really dry in the spirit. You need just a refreshing. You need a refreshing touch. If you're here, come on. Come stand right over here. Is there anybody else? You just need a refreshing of the Holy Spirit. Is there anybody else? Come on. All right, let me get my college pastor, my youth pastor. Come on. Y'all gather around this woman right now. Let's just pray a refreshing upon her. Now, Holy Spirit, make it real, Lord God. Father God, I declare over this woman to be past her past, to be past those circumstances, and I declare her eyes on you right now. Her eyes on you. Her eyes off of her circumstances and eyes on you. And God, I declare that as her eyes are on you, you said, I will keep them in perfect peace whose mind is stayed on me because they trust me. And Father, I speak over her right now to be filled with you completely, Lord God. Lord, I speak over her right now to receive more and more and more of you, a refreshing, Lord, of the Holy Spirit. God, I declare a refreshing of the Holy Spirit to be on her life right now. Father God, make her full of you, Lord Jesus. Full of you, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
I will worship Him and give the praise to Him alone. Marasa, He who was and is to come, I will sing before His throne forever. I will worship Him and give praise to Him alone. He who was and is and is to come, Mashita Makorasti, Habeshimotoska, it is the Yondavanabosia, yes, God, forever. Forever. I will praise the Lamb of God who sits upon the throne. I will worship Him and give the praise.